Indeed, it's no coincidence that the Patek Philippe Grand Exhibition coincides with a time that the country celebrates Time or Clock Day. That's the festival that celebrates the very first water clock introduced in Japan many ages ago.
The biennial global watch event of Patek Philippe opened its doors to the public on June 10th, National Clock Day. The two-week exhibition in Shinjuku's business center features a large selection of rare antique pieces, the brand's entire current collection, plus rare handcrafts and special edition watches created specially for the Tokyo edition. And surprise, two brand new movements making their debut in Tokyo. The historic Swiss brand from Geneva has deep roots in Japan. Not only is the country among its biggest and most avid watch markets, both share a common commitment to technological innovations, a focus on design, and attention to quality and detail. Indeed, one of the rarest Patek Philippe watches, and among the earliest traced in Japan, is on display here.
Ah, this is the piece we were talking about. You see, during the Edo period, Western clocks and, well, watches pretty much disappeared from the scene, only to return during the Meiji period. Now, this piece over here, for example, illustrates the popularity of Western watches after the Meiji Restoration. It's a world timer from 1939, made by Patek Philippe and lent to the exhibition by a local collector.
Peter Fries, the curator of the Patek Philippe Museum, walks me through the largest selection of museum pieces to leave Geneva so far.
Well, this is a very early timekeeper when it comes to world time. The number one world timer was in 1937 for the International Exhibition in Paris. We have it in the museum in Geneva, but having here one from 1939, that's a masterpiece for the show here.
In curating the 180 museum pieces for the exhibition, Peter consulted several Japanese collectors, and as expected, watches focusing on technical innovations were what excited them the most.
One of the early pieces which they really like is that piece here from 1546. It belongs to the eight oldest portable timekeepers in the world. And it was not actually done by a watchmaker, it was done by a locksmith. It's made completely out of iron.
Wow.
And when we have Japanese visitors in the museum, they're always very excited about that kind of movement, because just a few years later, you can see the difference.
And while most today view moon phase dials as merely decorative, Japan's long experience with the lunar calendar and cultural attachment to the moon make these earliest watches with a function a big hit with locals here. And if there's another thing Japanese love, it's combining miniaturized technology with the most minute details.
Made in the 1940s, and you almost cannot see the watch. So the watch becomes a hidden part in the object. So it has a little drawer where you can move out the movement and the dial. Here you have to open the bracelet to see the watch, so everything is hidden. A big piece like this, it's a favorite.
As rare and complicated and beautiful as these watches are, they all owe their existence to the crown-setting mechanism invented by co-founder Jean-Adrien Philippe.
This is at the heart of the brand.
And that's the heart of the brand. And I think that's a story which people really like to hear, because even if you don't wear a Patek Philippe, you can always say, I have a little bit of Patek Philippe in my watch.
Yeah.
This is like the iPhone. It was a game changer in the market. 30 years after that invention, no producer of watches was able to sell a watch with a key. They all had to have a crown. And once the Queen of England had one, then all the others wanted it too.
Speaking of whom, Queen Victoria's Patek Philippe watch is on tour as well, as are these rare Patek Philippe watches once owned by tycoons like Henry Graves Jr. and cultural icons such as Duke Ellington. You'll also find Patek's first ever wristwatch, piece commissioned by a Hungarian countess. But more than any other collection, it's the Japanese-themed pieces that piqued my imagination, and the special edition rare handcraft watches that are attracting the most attention.
Yes, there's a reason why they're crowding around in this room. See, this room is dedicated to rare handcrafts featuring themes from Japanese culture and history. It's an homage to the Japanese collector and watch connoisseur.
On display are 40 special edition timepieces, dome clocks, table clocks, pocket watches, and wrist-worn pieces made especially for the Tokyo Watch Art Exhibition. Each piece was handcrafted by Patek Philippe artisans and watchmakers in Geneva, all of which feature historical subjects, scenes from nature, and decorative motifs celebrated in Japan. Most stunning are the colorful timepiece in Grand Fru Cloisonné enamel with miniature painting, crafted using a delicate and time-consuming handmade technique that only the best and most experienced artisans in the Geneva workshops are capable of mastering. Stunning too, if you look closer, are the intricate and realistic details visible on the dials and case backs of these watches. From an eagle's feathers to the wood grain of an old temple, even soft snow falling in winter. Wood marquetry is another rare and delicate technique. Though this looks hand-painted, the portrait of the samurai is composed of 1,000 separate wood pieces. It's among the most complex wood marquetry creations of Patek Philippe ever. Often a variety of these techniques are used all together, such as this scene of Mount Fuji and Shizuoka, rendered in hand-engraved gold with cloisonné and flick enamel. And let's not forget the Patek Philippe mechanical movements that beat within each masterpiece. For this lovely bird on a red maple, the rare and intricate enamel dial was watched with an equally intricate and rare chiming minute repeater caliber.
There are a lot of parallelisms between Japanese culture in a way, and not just Swiss culture, but Patek Philippe culture. The precision, craftsmanship, attention to detail.
And the attention to design.
Correct.
That is so clean and so strong here in Japan, and very comparable to what we do over there.
Exactly.
Okay. Now they appreciate this kind of quality. It's when it comes to the detail, it's very important for them.
And of course, the use of the hand is something that's very special to the culture here. You still see it in the artisans of Japan today.
Yeah, and you see it with our craftsmanship, the rare craftsmanship. So I think we're very much aligned on that level, whether it comes to wood or painting or enameling. I think